The good news is that God's life-giving Spirit still breathes on us. Let us sing.
We look to Jesus for peace, and peace within us, and peace through us. Jesus offers peace that is to be extended toward others. Let us share the peace that is Christ with our neighbors. If you are joining us from home, please use the chat function to express your peace. Oh Lord, as we meditate on your word, may our hearts and minds be open to receive it. The scripture reading today is from the third chapter, John, verses 1 to 17. Now, there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him,
"Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with that person."
Jesus answered him, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being from above." Nicodemus said to him,
"How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?"
Answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him,
"How can these things be?"
Jesus answered him, "Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I say to you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. At our ministry team retreat last Saturday, the suggestion was, why don't we make sure our community knows more about what we do at Kids Time? And we said, oh, we can have the teachers come up and talk about it. And then somebody said, well, no, let's have the children tell about what they learned. So they were here yesterday, so that's what they learned about yesterday. So, okay, we're gonna have the sermon. Is that good? Okay. Thank you. Okay. We're continuing our Lenten series. Starts with the road to resurrection. We kind of look at Lent as a journey, a road leading up to the resurrection of Christ. And this year our theme is from grief to glory. And perhaps if some of you were here last week, you know we did some remembering of some of our grief as a community and as individuals. And we put our memories in the treasure box because we treasure our memories of those people we've lost. Today we move on to begin looking at a different story each week from the Gospel of John, an encounter of someone with Jesus. Reconciliation happens on many levels. The act of reconciling with another person assumes that although we might be separated from one another right now, there was something between us at one point. We were in connection with each other, in relationship with each other. Reconciliation means a return to what was. Reconciling the differences or a disagreement that you might have with someone. We're used to thinking about it directly with one other person, or it could be a group, I suppose, from whom you have been estranged. Physical, emotional, or spiritual separation are the kinds of losses that we experience in our lives. Relatives or friends can distance themselves from one another, maybe due to a sharp disagreement sometimes. Maybe due to different theologies or different belief systems or different political ideologies, people can become separated. But sometimes the distance just sort of creeps in over time. You get busy, you know, and you stop meeting for lunch and you stop calling them on the phone, and all of a sudden you realize you're grieving the loss of a relationship that you once had that was vibrant and nourishing to you. When our loss is a lack of closeness between us and another, then reconciliation, coming back together at some level, is possible as long as both sides are willing to do that. And the relationship ends up being renewed, or we might use the word reborn, started fresh. Another example is people sometimes talk about reconciliation between the races in this country. But when our loss is the centuries-old racial divide in this country, it's hard to say that blacks and whites need to reconcile when there really was never any equity for everyone from the beginning. Equity recognizes that people have different circumstances in this world, and people need differing amounts of resources and opportunities in order to reach an equal outcome. Housing, health, career opportunities, and more between whites and blacks in this country cannot be described as equitable. If reconciliation means getting back together, it assumes you were together in the first place. So I think a better way to think about dismantling racism is not just, it's really more rebirth, starting fresh, not going back to try to put something together that never was together, but restarting something fresh. We understand on another level that the coming of Jesus to this earth is God's plan for reconciliation with us. We human beings had gone so far afield from what God intended for us that we had become estranged, not on God's part, but on our human part. Our sin had separated us from God. Jesus' life, his death, his resurrection served to reconcile us with God, to bring us back together. We know that, reading our scriptures, hearing sermons all your life, perhaps. We live post-resurrection, and so we look back and we know that that was God's purpose in bringing and sending Jesus. But that concept clearly confused Nicodemus when he was having his conversation with Jesus. First off, Jesus identifies himself as God's son. And then he tells Nicodemus that he has to be born anew, and that anyone who believes in him as the Son of God will have life eternal. Well, it's almost comical when you think about that conversation between Nicodemus and Jesus. He's a well-educated lawyer. He's well-respected in the Jewish community, and he doesn't understand that Jesus is not talking literally here. You have to be born anew. He says, well, how can anybody return to a mother's womb once he's been born? Well, he's a well-educated guy. Jesus isn't talking about physical birth, of course. He's talking about spiritual rebirth, renewal, reconciliation with God. He's very clear that this is God's plan to reconcile with human beings. And it's Jesus who makes that reconciliation possible. Reconciliation, our reconciliation with God, brings rebirth on multiple levels. You could say that it enables us to have a fresh start in that relationship. It gives us maybe a new direction in that relationship with God. It helps us to turn over a new leaf, sometimes people say. Or it helps us to do a 180, which is another way people describe it. When we're reconciled, brought back together with God, we start walking in step with the Spirit. The Holy Spirit. We start seeking to follow the teachings of Christ and being grateful for the love of God just washing over us. Being reconciled with God definitely affects us inside. But being reconciled with God also affects our relationship with the world around us. When we're reconciled with God, we, in turn, seek reconciliation with individuals from whom we might be estranged. We seek reconciliation with the environment that we have damaged so severely. We seek reconciliation with neighbors who sometimes get defined as enemies. And what about on a larger scale, not just you and me, but reconciliation between fellow citizens in a country like Cameroon? Reconciliation between governments engaged or armies engaged in active warfare like Ukraine and the Soviet Union. Sorry, Russia. Or what about the decades-long Arctic relationship between the U.S. and Cuba? Asking our government to reconcile our differences with Cuba is an ongoing request of Presbyterian churches who have partners in Cuba. It's been a request for a long time. This week, a letter was circulated to us that has been drafted to send to the Biden administration by what a group called the Cuba Working Group. That group is calling on the administration to make the necessary changes to remove Cuba from the list of state sponsors of terrorism, with the goal of bringing rebirth of communication, trade, humanitarian support, and travel between the two countries. That working group, the Cuba Working Group, monitors Cuba's changing economic and political landscape and the U.S. ties with Cuba. They are kind of like a bridge between the public and private sectors, and they're a respected voice at the federal level. They look at investment opportunities and potential areas for collaboration between businesses, private, and public government entities. They are made up of a whole different group of people: telecommunications specialists, technology, financial services people, agriculture and food production, energy, hospitality, and legal services are all in that working group. And the churches listen and support and lend their voice to their statements and their letters. So the Cuba Working Group is probably not going to use the word reconciliation to describe their work, but looking to normalize relations between Cuba and the U.S. is exactly that, reconciliation. We used to have good relations many years ago. At times, we struggle with reconciling what we say we believe and what we actually do. Nicodemus was right in that struggle. When he comes to see Jesus, he's trying to make sense of an inner conflict that's going on inside him. He's drawn to Jesus and his teachings. His interest has been piqued. His heart has been opened. But at the same time, he's a respected Pharisee in the community. He's a leader in the Jewish establishment, which does not look favorably on this upstart and potentially dangerous preacher from Galilee. Dangerous to their power, that is. Because of Nicodemus' role in the Jewish community, because he has a reputation in society, and maybe even because he's afraid that his peers will find out, he's either a wannabe disciple or a secret disciple. He comes to Jesus under the cover of darkness, so he hopes nobody will see him. It seems like he's seeking to figure out a way to reconcile between what he wants to believe in Jesus in his heart and this faith that he's grown up with that has been rigid and unwilling to receive Jesus' different way of looking at things. He's been committed to uphold that faith as a Pharisee. So could he really be sure that Jesus is the Son of God? He needs to, like, really confirm that. Could he risk put-downs and being ostracized by his peers? What would following Jesus look like in his life on the ground? What would he have to change? He's in a difficult spot, but it's not a spot that we are unfamiliar with, is it? Haven't we all, at one time or another, been in a spot where we're afraid, hesitant to step into a new realm, to find a fresh start in our relationship with Jesus Christ? Have there been periods in our lives when we knew our actions or our words were not exactly fitting well with what we said we believe? I think about the German Christians in the 1930s who were so afraid not to follow the party line of the Nazis. They were afraid of their neighbors. They were afraid for their very lives if they didn't go along with the government. I am sure that many of them inside, privately, were struggling. How could they reconcile their belief in Jesus Christ and his love for all people with what the government was telling them to do? Very difficult struggle it had to be for many. Some of them formed what was called at that time the Confessing Church, and they bravely stood up against the actions of the Nazis. They committed to keeping their faith in God and their actions in sync. In the 1940s, together, they wrote a document which we call the Declaration of Barmen, Barmen being the city where it was written. They knew that writing this could get them killed. And some of them were. In this statement, which we have in our Book of Order, they make clear that their faith in Christ does require a rebirth. It does require starting fresh because Christ is over our entire life, all the pieces of it. Listen to this little excerpt from that document. They wrote, "As Jesus Christ is God's assurance of the forgiveness of all our sins, so in the same way and with the same seriousness, he is also God's mighty claim upon our whole life." Not just a piece of it. Belief and action reconciled, connected. When belief and action are reconciled, when they're in sync with one another, we might say, we've become something new. We've been born from above. We've been born of the Spirit and not simply of the flesh from our mother's wombs. Nicodemus was trying to make sure who Jesus really was. He wanted Jesus to affirm that, yes, he is from God. That, yes, Nicodemus is on the right track here. I think deep in his heart, Nicodemus was hoping that he just might have the courage to step out into the public light. If Jesus really were from God, then he could do it. And as far as we can tell, he kind of steps back into the shadows after this encounter. But if you read through this Gospel of John, later on, he pops back up. In chapter 7, he speaks out in front of the Jewish leaders who were suspicious and sneering about the authority of Jesus. He points out to them that their law provides that one must have a hearing before being judged. And they had not made room to listen to Jesus for themselves. He indicated to them publicly that he thought Jesus needed a hearing before they would condemn him as a heretic or as a threat to the Jewish faith. Again, at the end of the gospel, chapter 19, you can find it. After Jesus dies on the cross, Nicodemus joins with Joseph of Arimathea in removing the body from the cross. A very sacred and holy act. They take the body down, they anoint the body with a mixture of myrrh and aloe, spices and creams. They wrap the body in a cloth, a linen cloth, and they take the body and lay it in the tomb. Carefully, lovingly. It's the ultimate act of love and respect for this man, Jesus. He's openly now exhibiting his support for Jesus and his message. He's been reborn, if you ask me. He has started fresh in a new direction, no matter what those old cronies were going to say. Nicodemus has now brought his actions in line with his heart. And I'm sure that even in the midst of his sadness at the death of Jesus, he's feeling honored to accompany Jesus to his final resting place. It reminds me of the words I hear often at a cemetery. At the end of the graveside service, someone from the funeral home staff gets up and speaks to those who are gathered there, and they usually say something like this: "We thank each and every one of you for accompanying Frank, Nevaeh, Susie, whatever the name is. We thank each and every one of you for accompanying them on this final mile, for being there with the family to the very end, until the body is placed in the ground." That shows commitment. That shows loyalty. That shows love. Well, apparently Nicodemus had reflected on what Jesus said to him that night. Apparently, he decided he could reconcile his new belief and his actions. Right after that oft-quoted John 3:16 that everybody knows, John says that Jesus was sent into the world to save it, to reconcile us once again to our Creator, to enable us to start fresh and to be born anew. That goes for Nicodemus. That goes for those German Christians. That goes for you and for me. Thanks be to God. Amen.